In this video, I'm going to show you the prototype that you see playing behind the scenes, which I did to simulate what Saber does, but in augmented reality. I'm actually going to be using my face to avoid objects that are coming towards me, and as soon as I avoid an object, I'm going to be getting a point. If one of the objects hits my face, I'm going to be losing a point. So let's jump into Unity and start working on it. All right, guys, so let me show you this demo and basically how it works. So I'm going to launch it. You're going to see my face, and face detection is, you know, what I'm using to resemble the player. As I move away from the cubes, I am gaining points. So as soon as I hit to 10 points, and I think it's actually more than 10 points, it's going to start spawning double cubes. And that's what it's actually doing. So I'm getting, you know, I'm getting more points right now. And you can see that it's getting more difficult. So I wanted to do something similar to, you know, Beat Saber and implement that same functionality. So what I want to do now is I want to show you how this works. So let's go ahead and jump into Unity and show you the setup. I'm also going to be hiding this. So this is an AR game. I show you guys how to do this in AR Foundation, how to create an AR Foundation application. In this case, I wanted to do, you know, use face tracking to implement something like Beat Saber, because I had a client that wanted something similar than this. So I went ahead and prototyped it for them. And then that's basically what I'm going to be showing you. So in this one, I have the, you know, the structure that is required by AR Foundation, my AR session origin, a canvas, because I want to be able to show the score. So if we go here, you're going to see that I have the score here. We can also go into, let's go ahead and go into the game view, make sure that I have everything set to the right device, the right aspect. And right now I'm using the iPhone XR. So I have a canvas. It has a score, you know, very simple. I also have a logger just in case I need to debug this. And then when I reach, you know, zero, that's game over. So I'm basically just displaying the screen, and then the player can just restart the game. Something is very, very simple. So the challenge in here is we're dealing with faces and meshes that are generated, you know, by the framework. In my case, I'm using ARKit. So Unity is grabbing that information that they're getting from the face tracker and then building a mesh in real time. So one of the challenges was I needed to get the position of the face, and I wanted to span the objects on the, you know, relative to the face. Because when you're looking at the phone and you're basically holding the phone and you're looking at yourself, you got to think about the direction of where the objects are going. They're actually going to be hitting your face. It's actually more complicated than I thought it was going to be. But anyway, so I have these two spammers that are the ones that are responsible for spanning the game objects. So if we go here, I also added a gizmos because I was tired of trying to find out where they were in the editor view. So that's why the ones that are in yellow, that means that, you know, they are spanners. The other question here is when you're dealing with things that are in augmented reality, you want to make sure that you keep track of them, right? If you create a game object somewhere in here and the augmented reality, you know, framework doesn't know about them, it's not going to be able to keep track of their position and their location. So you need to start thinking about anchors, and that's what I ended up using for these two. Right now, you don't see the anchors in here because I'm doing that through code, and I'm going to show you how I do that. So these two components are fairly simple. They're just, it's a spanner script. It has a prefab, and this prefab is the one that you saw in the game view that I was actually, you know, instantiating, and the position of them was changing and directing towards the face, and that's why they have a movement script in them. You can also change the speed if you wanted to, and then tell the system at what point to destroy them. And I also do that through code, those are some of the options that you have in the inspector. This one also has a box collider and also a rigid body collider, because I am detecting, you know, when they hit the wall that is behind the head, that's when I know that you actually didn't, you know, you didn't actually hit the face. That way you get a point. So what I want to show you is, let's go ahead and look at this spanner one more time. So you can tell the system, you know, how fast or the frequency of when to span them. In this case, I'm gonna randomize, you know, from two to three seconds, I'm going to be spanning an object, and this is gonna be the object that I'm spanning. I also can set, you know, what the speed is gonna be. So this is the speed that I get, that it gets passed to into the movement script. In this case, I'm just saying, you know, the movement speed is gonna be 0.2. This is gonna be the gizmo size. So if we go ahead and look at that, let's say you wanna make the gizmo size pretty big. And this is just more for the editor, because I wanted, like I said, I wanted to be able to see where those spanners were. Otherwise, you're not gonna see it. You're only gonna see the transformation tool here. So I decided just to add that, and that way it'll make it easier for me to find it. And the last thing is just, you know, how fast do you want to destroy these game objects? So decided to do it after 20 seconds because they're going to be behind the wall, so I won't be able to see them. At some point, that wall is going to be transparent. I just decided to have it on so that I could actually see it hitting and actually seeing the value getting incremented. So, okay, so we have those two spanners. We have the AR session origin. In the AR session origin, you know, I have the same component. I have the AR phase manager because we need to tell the system, you know, what object is going to be instantiated when we detect a phase. In this case, I'm using this phase mesh that has the UV phase, which you saw in the video. So basically it has this texture. This texture is just a simple, you know, a simple map. So I could see just a cool map that I use normally for phase tracking. And then you can tell it how many phases. In this case, this game is going to be just one phase. So I just set these to one. And then I also have an anchor manager because I need to be able to anchor these two objects so that we can keep track of them in augmented reality and they don't start flying around like crazy. Basically, what this is going to do is just going to add an anchor, and it's going to make that anchor a parent of this child. And it's going to add another anchor, which is a pair. It's going to be, you know, this is going to be a child. The anchor is going to be the parent. And then I have an anchor manager so that I can keep track of basically these anchor managers. If I go into it, it's fairly simple. I have a private variable. I have a public property that is basically referencing the private variable here. And then on the awake method, I just get that component. So that's what this one is doing. So the next thing is, okay, now that you have that information, how does the actual objects that you are spanning, how do they move towards the face? And that's what I'm going to show you next. So if we look at the movement script, this is something that I had to, you know, that I implemented before. I just had to tweak it a little bit, but I have a speed. I have, you know, how fast am I going to be destroying? I show you that the spanner itself is going to be setting this. I also tell the system, okay, I want to track when the actual object has been avoided. That way I don't try to do any collision detection after I have avoided a cube. I also set the speed so that we know how fast we're going to be moving towards the face. I also have a target position, which in our case is going to be the face because that is the mesh that we want the cube object to be, you know, moving towards. I also have a private variable to determine if I have the target plan. The reason why I'm doing this is because I only want to plan the target at the beginning of the object instantiation. That way I don't change direction if the face is changing. So imagine if you change the face direction and you let the move towards position change, what's gonna happen is you're gonna move the face, the cube is gonna follow the face, and that's not gonna be very fair. So what I do is I just get the position at the very beginning, and then I said, okay, I know where the face is right now at this point, but then I have the chance to be able to move my face around. That way the game is almost impossible to beat. I also have an AR face manager because I need to get a reference of that so I know when the face is changing, and I also have a reference to the face itself so that I know the face mesh that is getting created. So on enable, I get the face manager, which is part of this component. I also bind myself to the faces changes. And then, you know, whenever this executes, I'm going to have this method that is going to get executed as soon as there's a change on the face. So if you smile, if you move around, something like that happens, then I know that this method is going to get executed as long as your device supports face tracking. I want to keep that in mind so that, you know, if you're using older device, you're not trying to make it work because it might not work. You need to have, you know, and I'm going to put that information in the description to tell you what devices are going to support this technology. But it's going to be very similar to, you know, every other one of my videos on face tracking. Just make sure that you use the latest and greatest because, unfortunately, that's the state of things right now. And so when this gets executed, what I'm saying, okay, you know what? As long as I have a face, and the face count, the face that I detected is greater than zero, and I haven't planned the target location where we're going to be moving this object to, then I'm going to do this. That way, if this is already been set, I don't do this again. Otherwise, we don't get the face location again. That way, it's kind of like cheating, right? But you can change this algorithm, however you think it's going to work best for you. You can probably do it, you know, once every couple of frames. If you want to change the difficulty, that it's really up to you. So as soon as that happens, I haven't planned the target, you know, my final destination. Then I get the face. This gives me the face. I also get a component that it's in the face itself, which I call the detector. I get the position of that. And then I'm just saying, you know what? The target position, I'm going to calculate it based on the phase transform position. And I'm going to add an offset for the detector position. This is just an offset so that I know that as soon as you hit the phase, we have a little gap in between to tell the system, to tell this object how far to go. And then I just say, you know, the target position, the target destination was already being planned, so that way we don't get into this again. This is only going to get executed once as soon as the phase is detected. That way, you know, we don't do it, like I said, on every single frame. So, and then the next thing that I do is, you know, as long as the target position is not equal to zero, because that's going to be the target position that I initialize this with. If the target position changed, that means that I detected what the final destination is of this object. So then I know that I need to, you know, change my delta time. That way I can move the cube towards the target position of the face. So as you can see here, this location of the cube is going to be moving based on the step from the target, from the position that I have right now where the cube is, to the target position. So that's what does basically the movement of the cube. And then when we're talking about collision detection, because I needed to find out, okay, did I hit the player, which means that I hit the face, or did I hit the wall, which means that I got a point. So in the case that I hit the player, which is in my case is my face, I know that I lost a point, right? So what I do is I'm using tags for that, and I'm saying, okay, as long as this object has not been avoided, I'm going to check the tag, and if the tag of the object that I'm colliding with is the player, I'm going to check again and make sure, okay, I haven't avoided it. If I haven't avoided it yet, I'm going to set this to true. I'm going to be decrementing the points because we hit the face. And then I'm going to destroy that this game object based on the destroy after that variable. If the object that I'm not colliding with is not player, then I'm going to check, okay, well, maybe the object that I'm colliding with is going to be is a score. And in this case, it's going to be the score wall. In this case, I'm going to get a point because I was able to avoid the cube. So I do the same checks. It's just a different tag. I also change this to avoid it equal true. And then I also increment the points because, yeah, we actually avoided the cube. And then I destroy the game object based on the same parameters that I showed you previously. So that's how the movement script works. The spanners itself, I haven't shown you that, but this is the game object that I show you in the hierarchy. The implementation is pretty simple. I have an object that I reference that I'm going to be spanning. In this case, it's going to be the movement object, the cube that I show you. Also, the span minimum seconds, the maximum seconds, because I want to know, okay, from these, you know, from 1 second to 3 seconds, I want to be able to span an object, and I want to randomize those values. This is going to be the speed. This is the gizmo size so that I can see it through the editor view. And then also track, you know, generated in seconds. You know, this is basically a variable that I store based on the random number that I generate from the minimum span in seconds and also the maximum value of my span in max seconds. I also use, you know, I also have a variable here that determines when we're going to be destroying those objects. I show you that in the inspector, and also a timer here to detect at what point I'm going to be spanning a new object. The most important thing about this script, I mean, everything else is important in order for this to work, but one thing that is tricky for a lot of people that are building, you know, augmented reality experiences is they don't take into account that they need to create an anchor of an object so that it knows, you know, relative to the real world space, where to put and position that object so that basically the transforms of that object get updated. It basically becomes a trackable, and then the system will track, you know, where that object is in respect to the AR world. So the way that I do that is I have a reference to I have a singleton, which I show you the anchor manager, and then I access the singleton, then I access the AR anchor manager, I add a new anchor, and then I add that new anchor at the position of this game object. That way I know that this game object is going to be at that position relative to what I put in the editor, and that's going to be, you know, all converted to the augmented reality world position. So I pass in the transform position of this object and also the rotation. Basically, position and rotation is what that gets. And then the most important thing about this is that I basically parent this object to the anchor that I'm creating. That way, that object is not going to be moving around. It's not going to lose track of the AR session. Once I get that, then I know and I'm guaranteed that this is going to be, you know, this is going to be positioned correctly. And the rotation is going to be also, you know, precise. And then what I do is I basically have my logic in here to expand a new object. I just check, okay, has my timer hit the maximum? If it has hit the maximum, which in my case is generated seconds, I'm going to create a new instance. I also going to parent this new instance to basically this game object. So this is really important as well, because I know that this object right here, it has an anchor on. So why create another anchor on this object if I already have an anchor on this banner? So that's what I decided to do, is I grab the new object that I'm creating and I'm basically making that a child of this object. And then I get the movement component, I set the speed, I also tell it when to destroy it. I set the timer to zero so that we can expand it again after we hit the generated seconds again. And then I just recalculate the minimum and the max, just in case you want to change that during runtime. And then if we're done here, I know that I'm starting at zero, this is gonna be false. I'm gonna basically be incrementing my timer. So, and then this is basically so that I can see the yellow, basically like the yellow gizmo, which is a sphere, and I'm just, you know, telling the system to use the yellow color, because that to me will stand out. So that's basically that component, and then the spanner component, the movement component. UI manager is fairly simple, just basically keeps track of what I'm getting from the canvas. It's also, in this case, this game was something that I did in just a few, you know, in less than an hour. So I didn't want to spend too much time on it. All I'm doing here is I'm tracking the points. I have a method to increment points, a method to decrement points, and also a method to restart the game. Yeah, this is the UI manager. The UI manager shouldn't be responsible for keeping track of the score, but this is a prototype. We don't really need to make it too complicated. I could have done a score manager as well, but it wasn't really needed at this point. If you want to do it, you know, you can definitely do that. So that's everything. And then I think the last one that I can cover as well is the player manager. This one is just basically keeping track of the face itself. I don't really have much going on in here. The reason why I did this is because I wanted to, you know, perhaps have a power-up that you could smile. And basically, if the blend shape on your smile gesture had a specific value, I could, you know, maybe expand an object from your face and then maybe have a power-up where you can, I don't know, shoot one of the cubes. But I didn't do anything else on here. This is just one implementation that I could use to do that. So like you can see in here, this is jaw open and I'm tracking that blend shape. So I'm not gonna go too much into this because this is really not completed yet. But that's honestly everything that I wanted to show you. I'm not gonna post this code just yet because the client that asked me for that code is, you know, is currently using it. But I'm gonna be making it available in about a week in Patreon. So if you guys wanna check it out in Patreon in about a week from today, make sure that you sign up on one of the early, you know, early access to code. And as soon as that becomes available, I'll be sending a communication to everyone.
All right, guys, thank you for watching this video today. I really appreciate your time. And if you have any questions about anything that I just mentioned, please let me know in the comments. Also, be sure to check out learnxr.io, where I'm basically doing VR training and also upcoming augmented reality training. Also, find me in patreon.com for early access source code and also everything that I'm doing behind the scenes. Thank you, guys.